Okay, so the next topic and that we are considering, we started on it last time, was the construction of large memory array, right? So the problem that we are interested in is to see how you can construct a memory array. So first of all, what do we understand when we say a memory array? What are the requirements that we have of it? Okay, let's get an understanding of that. The typical understanding, at least now that we are familiar with how a microprocessor or microcontroller works, we have a good understanding of what we mean when we say we want to use a certain type of memory block. Right? So the typical view of memory inside a microprocessor is something like this. We think of it as this long sheet of paper or some substance where there are addresses. Right? And depending on the address, you would have data which is stored in the block. Okay? And each of these in turn contains some collection of bits. Okay? And typically what we are interested in is some n different memory locations or whatever, n different memory locations. Okay? Or let me put it another way, what we would typically have is some 2 to the power of n different memory locations, which means that we can have essentially an address which consists of n bits. Okay? So there is an address of n bits. There is any 1 or 2 to the power of n different memory locations that you can access as a result of addressing that memory. Each location contains some n bits of data. And we want to be able to do 2 things with this. One is, we want to be able to read from it. And we want to be able to write new data into these locations. Okay? This is what we want to do with the memory array. We want to have a memory block that can be addressed and can also be written into or read out of. Okay? So with that in mind, let's look at one possible way by which we can construct such a thing. Okay? So the first thing is, let's take the n-bit data. How do I store 1 bit of memory somewhere? What kind of elements do we know of for storing a single bit of memory? A latch. Right? The simplest one that we can think of is a latch. Right, so there is an enable signal or a clock signal or a gating signal, whatever you want to call it. When that enable signal is high, I can write data into this latch. And when do I read data from the latch? What do I need to do in order to read data from the latch? Nothing. Right, I mean it's always present at you. Right? This latch as it stands is a single bit of data. It always presents whatever is contained inside the latch at the output. Okay. So that's something to think about. The fact that a latch by itself always presents data at its output may not be good news for us when we want to read from one of many different locations. We need to now be able to select which of those locations we actually want to read from. Okay. But this also allows us to write new data into the latch by means of the enable signal. Okay? So this is 1-bit storage. Clearly what I can do is I can group m of these together, right? Connect a single enable signal to all m of those latches, and as a result I'll have a m-bit storage. Right? I give a common enable signal, but different data signals and different Q signals. I'll call this D0 and Q0, D1, Q1, D2, Q2, and so on. Okay? Up to Dm minus 1, Qm minus 1. Right? So, what this has created is one single block. With a n bit D input, an m bit Q output, and one single enable signal. Okay? So by means of that enable signal, when I make the enable signal equal to 1, all m of those bits, be it 8 bits or 16 bits or 32 bits or any other number that I want, all m of those bits will get new data at the same time. Then I make the enable signal back to 0, and whatever was written in there will be stored and will be present at the output of those n bits. Okay. So, ganging or grouping m of these latches together by using a single enable signal is a trivial thing to do. Okay. Question is, what are the remaining things that we need to do? We need to be able to control when we can access any one of these 2 power n such blocks. I need to now put together 2 power n such blocks and control when I can read from them and when I can write into them. Okay? So let's first look at the problem of how I can do the reading. I want to be able to read only from any one of 2 power n such n bit blocks. Each of these is an n-bit block. There are 2 power n of them. How do I select any one of them for the output? Multiplexer. Right? So we already know what is the hardware that is needed for this. It's a multiplexer. What happens is I take all the n bits of this out. This will also have m bits. This will have m bits. I am going to draw this as one single multiplexer. Right? How many select lines must the multiplexer have? N select lines. Right? So there are 2 power n different possibilities. They are selected by means of n different select lines. The only thing that you need to keep in mind is the multiplexer operates in groups of n. Effectively, this is n different multiplexers. Right? Once again, group together to look like one unit. Right? So this I'll call a n cross m multiplexer. Okay? Not standard terminology, but I'm just using this over here. Usually we write it as n cross 1 or 2 power n cross 1. Right? So in this case 2 power n cross n. 2 power n different inputs are available. I want one of them to be available at the output. In this case, I am going to say that it's a 2 power n cross n multiplexer. This is not standard terminology. Right? But the important point is what happens over here is now, by means of this, I have figured out how I can group 2 power n of these things together and use it as a block from which I can read data. Right? By giving that address, n bit data, n bit address, I can select which one of the 2n blocks comes to the output of the multiplexer, and therefore I have a 2n selection of n bits. Okay, so reading can be done in this fashion. Right. The next question becomes, how do I do writing into this set of n bit blocks? What is it that controls whether I am writing something into a block? The enable signal, right? So what I can do is, I'll take my data bus, whatever I'm using for writing, and connect it to all of the blocks. Okay? So this is a common data write bus that I am connecting to everything. Okay. Now what I do is, I enable only one of those blocks. How do I do that? I need to have something which is the opposite of a multiplexer. A multiplexer takes 2n inputs and gives me one output. Now I need to take a 1 from somewhere, right? Put it through a select of n bits, and exactly 1 out of the 2n outputs which it has should become equal to 1, all the others should become equal to 0. Okay? So the symbol used for this is also the opposite of a multiplexer. So the n-bit address is fed in here. And exactly 1 out of 2n enable signals becomes equal to 1. Or possibly none of them. If none of the values are equal to 1, for that I need to do something else. I need to have some way of disabling this structure entirely. Right? And say that none of the 2n different values becomes equal to 1. Right? So that cannot be done just by having one of the n-bit addresses itself. I cannot just feed an address 0000 and expect that corresponds to none of the signals being selected. I need some other signal which tells me whether or not I am actually trying to write into it. So there has to be a write enable signal that comes from somewhere. Right? It actually tells me, yes, I am trying to write. Where am I trying to write? Into the n address, into the address corresponding to these n bits. And all m of the bits in that group must be written into. Okay? So the data is coming from the common data write bus. This structure over here is what's called a decoder. Right? What has it done? It has taken n bits as input, and exactly 1 out of the 2n outputs which it has will become equal to 1, all the others will become equal to 0. Right? The one that has become equal to 1, all the latches corresponding to that line alone are enabled, which means that whatever data is there on that common data write bus will get written into those latches. All the other latches will remain holding the value that they have the last. They have not been enabled. Okay? So effectively with this, what we have is, this memory block can be constructed as, I have n bit data in, this is the data write bus, n bit data out, the read bus, n bit address, one bit write enabled signal, and in some cases you might also find a read enabled signal. The difference is, what happens is, if you have a read enabled signal, then when the read enabled signal is not active, that multiplexer output is tri-stated. It's made floating. Okay, you put a transmission gate at the output of the multiplexer and say, don't select it. So the entire multiplexer output goes floating. Now that can be useful, for example, when I want to connect multiple of these blocks together. Right? So this entire thing together, I'm going to call it a RAM block. Right? So now we can get a basic idea of how a RAM block is constructed. We want to have 2n locations of storage, each one having n bits of data. Okay? This is how it gets constructed. Ultimately, internally, there are some kind of latches that need to be created. The latches have to have some enable signals. The enable signals are generated depending on whether you are reading or writing for the multiplexer or for the decoder, or from the decoder. Okay? And that decides which data comes out onto the data out bus and where the data on the data in bus gets written. Okay? So this is the basic structure. The tricky part over here is, it looks fine on paper when I draw it like this. The question is, what happens when, for example, I want to design a memory block which has a large number of locations. Okay? So let's consider, for example, eight memory locations, 2 bits of data in. Right? So what happens over here? I'll have 3 bits of address, select lines over here, the latches in this, there are 2 sets of latches, all of those outputs go to two multiplexers and you essentially get the 2-bit output. Easy enough to construct. The problem is, I am very rarely trying to design such small systems. What I am interested in is something which is considerably larger than this. Right? Let's say that I want to have a 10-bit address. So this is 2^10 location. Right? Of 8-bit C. Now what happens is, my memory starts looking very long and narrow. Right? So I have 2^10 different memory locations, just 8 bits of output. Okay? Which means that in the layout that I am trying to do, this is going to start looking a little bit tricky. What I will need to do is to sort of see if I can package this in a slightly different way. Then I maybe break this up into a few different blocks. Right? And see whether I can group these together. Right? One way of doing it is to save this output just continues in this way, and I have one very long block, but the layout becomes a bit more complicated. Right? So instead, what is done in such large cases, now by the way, 2×10 locations is still a very small memory. The typical size of memory that we are interested in is going to be hundreds of kilobits, megabits, at least. Okay? Nowadays, the kind of memory that we are dealing with in regular memory blocks in systems is going to be in the gigabit range. In fact, gigabyte range, which is tens of gigabytes. Okay? So we need some better way of handling this kind of a structure so that your memory block doesn't become one very long and narrow thing which is almost impossible to lay out properly. Right? So what is done in such a situation is, instead of just saying I'll take this entire long thing and just break it up into strips of this sort, we say the problem with that is you need to now have an extremely long and complicated decoder. Right? One decoder which has to be able to give the output of 2×10 different memory locations. Okay? Or if we have 1 megabit of RAM of memory, the decoder must give 2×20 or 10^6 different outputs. Only one of them must be equal to 1, all the others must be equal to 0. Okay? So this clearly is not a realistic way of designing large memory blocks. What we need to do instead is to see if we can break this up into some kind of a hierarchy of blocks. So what we say is, let's say a 1 megabit decoder, right? So 2×20. What I'm going to do is break it up into different blocks. And let's say that this has 2×12 elements. Okay, that is 4096. That's still pretty large. Constructing one decoder which gives you 4096 outputs is not going to be a trivial task. Right? Designing such a decoder itself is tricky. We saw an example of what happens with decoders when we were looking at the problem of logical effort. Right? We essentially saw what is involved in constructing a decoder. But that was a very, very small decoder. It was just a 4×16 decoder. So 4 inputs and 16 select lines. When I have 4000 select lines, I can't really construct a NAND gate which takes 12 inputs and gives me one output corresponding to 4000 different combinations. Okay, I need better ways of constructing decoders. But there are ways of constructing such decoders which depending on time, we'll look at it in a little. We'll at least try to take a look at some of the possibilities later. For the time being, we are not going to go into that. Okay? The point is, it's much easier to construct a 4000 element decoder than a 1 million element decoder. Okay? So what I do is I construct this with 4096 different values. This gives an 8-bit output, this gives an 8-bit output, and so on. Okay? Each of these 8-bit outputs is already something which is coming from a multiplexer. Right? So, in the case of reading also, I can think of the multiplexer as taking a decoder and having a transmission gate, it essentially gets enabled by that decoder. Right? So, one way of constructing a multiplexer is to say, I have some data and I will just connect all of these together to an output. Okay, just short all the wires together. ensure that exactly one out of S0 to Sk is equal to 1. Right? Only that transmission gate will drive the output. All the others will be floating. Okay? So, with this in mind is what you are drawing this kind of a structure. Effectively, what I am going to do here for the output multiplexers is, rather than creating explicit multiplexers, I will just use a decoder and transmission gate in order to implement the multiplexer. Okay? So now, what happens is, I have already got each of these 8-bit outputs is coming from some multiplexer output. Now what I need to do is put another level of multiplexing over here, where I finally select only actually 8 bits as output. How many select lines will go in here? How many different blocks will I have in this hierarchy? 2 power 8. Right? See, I had a total of 20 address lines, 1 megabit of memory that I was trying to create. Okay? 12 of those went to the individual block. So I have 2 power 12 data coming out of each, 2 power 12 data, out of which one is going to get selected from each block. Okay? This is the remaining 2 power 8. Okay? So there is an 8-bit must select signal that needs to be given. Effectively, it's easy for me to implement this. All that I need to do is take my 20-bit address, take 12 of the bits, give it to the one which selects within each block. The remaining 8 bits I use in order to select which of those blocks was actually the correct one. Okay? This is usually broken into two stages. What we say is we call this the row address. And then this becomes the column address. Right? Why is that? Because we have broken it into, what has effectively happened is, this 2 power 12 bits have selected this entire row. Right? Of 2 power 8 times 8 different values. And set them into the multiplexer. So from each column, one 8-bit data comes through to the multiplexer. And the column select then has to take care of selecting which of those 2 power 8 different values was the actual value that you wanted to read. Think about the way that we have done this. We can also easily do this for writing. Right? The writing would just be the reverse of what we have done. After all, we have figured out how to break the decoder essentially. Right? Which means that as far as writing is concerned, also I need to somehow figure out how to provide the data bus to all of these blocks. Make sure only one of the columns gets selected depending on the column into which I want to write. And within that column, only one of the rows gets selected. Okay? As long as I can do this kind of a hierarchical grid, you break it up into rows and columns, I can make the overall aspect ratio that is the ratio of rows is to columns will be made much better than in the case of a single column of data. Okay? So the aspect ratio you would have come across this in different terms. Typically what I say is, supposing I have a block like this, it has a width of W and a height of X. Aspect ratio is W squared. Right? The most common places where you will see this mentioned is when you are talking about monitors. Right? You will hear of things like 4:3 ratio, aspect ratio, or 16:9 aspect ratio, which are common ratios for the sizes of monitors. Okay? Now the aspect ratio plays an important part in the design. As far as we are concerned, a skewed aspect ratio, one where W is much greater than X, is difficult to create a good VLSI layout for. Okay? So desirable is to have W close to X, so that it becomes something like a squarish block. Okay? That gives us the maximum flexibility in terms of how we are designing. Of course, in some cases you might find that making it actually square is a bad idea. Some kind of a rectangle may be okay. But I definitely don't want 1,000,000:1. 1,000:1,000 or 10,000:100 may also be acceptable. Right? But 1,000,000:1 is definitely not acceptable from a VLSI layout point of view. Yes? Now obviously there is no reason to stop here in two dimensions, right? If I am going to do this breaking up into rows and columns, I can also go into one further dimension and create essentially blocks of blocks, right? So what I can do over there is I can take the overall address and break it up into J bits. Which selects the block, K bit which selects the row, and L bit which selects the column. Okay? You could also go further and make multiple banks of memory, multiple groups of banks, and so on, right? You can actually go further and further as far as this is concerned. Right? There is nothing really limiting you except for the fact that it gets more and more complicated to implement after a while. Okay. But depending on what your layout is like, what your chip design is like, you might want to break it up into multiple blocks that are grouped together in this fashion. Okay? Of course, once you have gone into the third dimension, there is also the tricky part that the actual VLSI layout is itself a two-dimensional thing. Right? It's not as if it's actually stacked one on top of the other, at least not in the regular VLSI designs. Nowadays, we are coming to the point of three-dimensional stacking, where multiple memory blocks are stacked one on top of the other in the third dimension, on silicon. That's not what we are talking about over here. This is purely a sort of conceptual breakup into multiple dimensions. Okay? So anyway, this is how memory blocks can be created, in the hierarchy can be implemented so that large memory blocks can be implemented efficiently in this fashion. Okay? Alright. So now let's go deeper into this and try and understand the remaining part, which is the latches themselves that actually store the memory. Okay? So before we go into the full-blown latches that actually can be both written into and read out of, we are going to concentrate on one part where you only read out of the memory. Okay? So in other words, let's look at the structure of ROM, the read-only memory section. Okay? And I want to have some kind of a structure which I can create during the VLSI layout, which will tell me for each row and column intersection as per this hierarchy, what data is stored at that intersection. Okay? So typically in this same hierarchy that we have over here, right, we also call this, we have two terms, one is the word line right? What a word line does is, select one word or one row. Okay? And within that row, you will have this line. Okay? So leaving aside the hierarchy, forget about the fact that you might have multiple rows and columns and so on. Think of it as though it is just one single column that we are interested in. Even within that, I have word lines where the word line essentially selects one row. Right? And within that one row, I have m columns or m bits being stored. Okay? So I have this word line and bit line are the two sort of fundamental constituents of how we select a particular piece of data. Okay? And at a given intersection between a word line and a bit line, I want to know what data is stored. Is it a 0 or a 1? Exactly one bit of data will be stored at the intersection of a word line and a bit line. Okay? The question becomes, how do I decide that that is either a 0 or a 1? Okay? The word line is an electrical wire. A bit line is also an electrical wire. At the output of the bit line, I want to have either a logic 0 or a logic 1 depending on what was stored at the intersection of that word line and bit line. Okay? And my question is, how can I then have some way of figuring out that this was either a 0 or a 1 that was stored over there? Right? So one way that I am going to propose for this is to say, let me take a number of bit lines. I'll just consider 4 bit lines. And somehow, let's say through a resistor, pull all of them up to VDD. Okay? Now if this is all that I had, and I consider the output from here, DL0, DL1, DL2, and DL3. I am telling you that DL0, DL1, DL2, DL3 is my output word. Okay? What will I see as the output anytime that I try to read from it? It's always 1. Right? Because I have a pull-up resistor, which means that it's going to be VDD over there. The logic value is going to be always seen as a 1. Okay? Now let's say that I have a word line over here. But this word line is just one horizontal wire which goes across this without touching anything. Okay? There is another word line, WL1, which also does the same thing. Nothing has changed. Right? Because the WL0 and WL1 lines are not touching any of the other internal lines. So when I try reading from this, I look at DL0, DL1, DL2, DL3, the output is still 1111. Okay? But now, I introduce some extra transistors over here. What I am going to do is, I will put a transistor here, an NMOS transistor, connect its gate to WL0, drain to BL0, source to ground. What happens now? When I try reading WL0, that is I make WL0 equal to 1. What will I see at the output of BL0, BL1, BL2, BL3? 0, 1, 1, 1. Right? The BL0, this point over here, will get pulled down. Because I have activated WL0, right? That in turn has activated that NMOS transistor, pulls the output down to ground. Okay? So by adding this transistor over here, let's say that I also have to add another transistor somewhere here. These three transistors are there in the system. Okay. So corresponding to WL0, what will be the B0 to 3? BL0 will be pulled down, so it is 0. BL1 is not pulled down, so it remains at 1. BL2 is also pulled down. BL3 is not pulled down. Okay? Instead, if I make WL1 equal to 1, what will be the output? 1, 0, 1, 1. Okay? So what have I done over here? I essentially said, I constructed a simple grid. Okay? I can only read from this, I cannot write into it. Because I cannot create new transistors on the fly. Right? But by positioning those transistors, what I can say is, as long as I try reading from the data, how do I read from it? I activate the word line. Whichever word line that I activate, that data will come out on the bit. On the bit line. BL0, BL1, BL2, BL3. Okay? In this case, if I activate WL0, the output will become 0101. If I activate WL1, the output will become 1011. Okay? So how do I store a 1 in this kind of a grid? Nothing to do. Don't put a transistor, that's all. At that intersection. How do I store a 0? Put an NMOS transistor with drain connected to the bit line, source connected to ground, and the gate connected to the word line which you want to select. Okay? This is one way by which I can create a ROM, a read-only memory. It's read-only because there is no way that I can create those transistors when I am using the system. I have to do this while I am making the chip in the first place. Once I have made it, the data cannot change. Okay? So there are a few alternatives to this. One thing that I can do is also, let's say that I have a word line and a bit line. Okay? And I just put a diode between these. Now what will happen? When the word line becomes 1, what will I see on the bit line? I'll see a 1. Right? When the word line becomes 1, I'll see a 1 on the bit line. When the word line becomes 0, what will I see on the bit line? Huh? You have to pull it down. If you don't pull it down, it's just going to float. Okay? So if I put a pull down resistor over here, then this is a 0, this is a 1. The output is taken from here. Okay, this is one way of doing it. I could also have done this. Using this, right? What is the difference between these two? In the first case, the word line through a diode is directly providing whatever current is required for the bit line to be pulled up. That's not going to be easy, right? The word line then has to be a very powerful driver, big transistor that can deliver a large amount of current. Why? Because a given word line is connected to many different bit lines, and the bit line in general has a large capacity. Why? Because it's going through so many different word lines. Okay? In the second case, we have switched it around so that there is an active device, a transistor, that is actually providing the current that you need. Okay, as soon as the W becomes equal to 1, the transistor turns on and that takes care of pulling up the bit line. the other. So both of these are different options from what we saw earlier, right? What we saw over here was that we have a pull up, and the function of the transistor is to pull the output down to ground. Both are perfectly fine. There's no real difference between the two. Both are acceptable ways of implementing, right? What is done in practice, however, is to say for the pull up, instead of having a resistor, what is the other option that you can use? I want to have something which pulls up the bit line, right? What do I do to the bit line to pull it up? Huh? Put a PMOS with, what do I do to its gate? Ground again. Okay? So this is one word line. Let's say this is another word line, which is also storing a 0. So what do I have? This. Okay? Now, if I look at the bit line output, what logic function of word line is it implementing? If I take the word lines as input, bit line as output, is it an inverter or something a bit more than that? Because there are multiple word lines. Of course, at any given point, only one of the word lines will be 1. It's a NOR gate, right? Think about this. What is it doing? Any one of the word lines becomes equal to 1, the bit line is going to be pulled to 0. Okay? So this is a NOR gate. And so this kind of ROM is called a NOR ROM. Okay? The idea is that whenever any word line becomes equal to 1, that corresponding bit line gets pulled down to 0. By default, the bit lines are pulled up to 1 by the PMOS transistor. So overall, this structure is specifically a pseudo NMOS NOR gate. Right? And effectively what is being done in this is to implement a large number of pseudo NMOS NOR gates in order to implement the complete ROM. Okay? Now, from a layout point of view, what do you think would be the requirements of this? Are there any possible drawbacks that you can think of, which could be a problem for implementing this from a layout point of view? Problem meaning it's not that it makes it impossible to implement, it's just that it should make the size a bit larger. See, what do you need to do as far as connecting and as far as storing a 0 is concerned? You need to connect the drain to the bit line and source to ground, which means I need access to ground somewhere. And in the layout, I need to make sure that for every row that I am trying to select, there is one ground line which is there near. Okay? So that I can connect that transistor to the bit line and also to ground. Okay? Because of that, the area of this kind of a structure can be large. Large meaning it's all relative, of course. But the point is that looks like one place where we can probably save something. Okay? So we'll stop here for now. Next time we'll look at extension of this. The next modification is how do we get rid of that ground and make a different kind of structure which can implement. Okay?